buddies. Paul Roberts, RT1 here. And today we take the mold apart and see whether we got what we wanted. Trivia question for you today. As you watch this video, try to decide what has appeared and disappeared that doesn't belong. And the last time I offered just one video, so I'm just giving you all five of these videos today. Just because. And they're just used anyway. But hey, why not? We might as well celebrate that we've got something. What have we got here? Let's take a look. Oh, old business. Let's finish up old business first. You know, the neck piece and the cape shield. People were saying, hey, people would want these. Well, I've got them available. The ones that I just let go that were perfectly fine that I showed in videos a few back didn't even go for the cost of materials. So this is your hint. Yes, we have no cape shields. We have no cape shields today. Okay, what's that from? You don't have to tell me, but that'll give you a hint as to what you're looking for. Okay, here we go. Now, there's one thing I forgot to talk about last time. We'll see whether that really affects things or not. And that is, a lot of times I'll spray the interior of this foam core with Krylon Crystal Clear. You don't have to, but you may have a little bit harder time getting it apart. So basically, we only used, oh, it came right off. Look at that. No big deal. We used very simple stuff. So this is a fraction of an 18 by 24, $1 piece. We're looking at maybe a quarter or less. So the mold didn't cost us anything, but our time, our troubleshooting previous to this time to get to where we can do this, which I'm hopefully saving a few of you from having to do as much of, and the cost of the materials, which, as you know, I estimated at only 20 ounces, and it worked out that that was enough. So I didn't glue the thing down. This is one of my old, almost 20-year-old pieces, and we may have a few undercuts, so it may require a little bit of trimming, but it'll help that I didn't glue it down to get it up off of this surface. Remember, silicone tears, just like urethane and things like that, so handle it gently, and it'll treat you well. I'm guessing there could be some undercuts because I attached this bat to that background for the belt buckle, and I can't remember whether I sealed the area where I attached it or not. I'm getting a little bit of resistance. I'm thinking I didn't seal it, but no big deal. But that's when we're gentle. If we get any tears before we trim it, then there'll be minimal tears and they won't affect our work. All right, looks good. There you go. A little bit of trimming on the outside. I'll show you in a minute. A little bit of leakage there like I thought, and we'll take that off. The mold is, I'd say, perfect. See how simple it is? Now this is the simplest mold you'll ever do. I could show you other molding techniques, and I may. The piece, I didn't glue it down, but it stuck. So there must've been a little bit a silicone that seeped under the piece itself. No problem, we'll go ahead and get that. Super cheap, less than a buck. But why buy another one? If you don't have a lot of things to do, just clean it. Sure enough, just a little bit of silicone there. And that's why I said be gentle. If there's any tearing, it's gonna be minimal. It's irrelevant because you won't even be filling it up past that point. This, most of it'll come out right off the bat because it's set up. And if you do a good mixing job, you can get the whole thing out almost in one pull. Very good. We mixed it and we can use our thing again because of that. But even if you didn't mix it perfectly, you should be able to get everything out of there. Just like we just pulled that silicone off of the piece, we can pull the silicone out of the bucket and use it again. So I just saved myself a buck. Why do I do this? I don't have to, but it's a lifetime endeavor to be wise, and I don't want to say cheap because you have to have money to be cheap. Frugal, I don't want to say that because that implies that we're doing something in an unbalanced way. Save a penny, earn a penny. You know, the old wives' tales. There's a lot of truth. So that's ready to be used again. Get this out of the way. So obviously the mold trimming, this doesn't even need to be done, but you might as well be a neat housekeeper. You know, just simply go like this if you want to, that's fine. That's one way to do it. That's pretty successful. So let me go ahead and do that on the edges. And another way to do it is just simply take this, the thing you use for cutting your eyes and such on cowls that are cast. And we have this. Now let me show you the final step that you're gonna have to mold cleanups. I don't mind if every casting has a little bit of an undercut because you can't see it. I did this 20 years ago and I did it fast. And I did it for my purposes, and then I realized, oh, you know, people want this, and I did more of them. What I could have done or should have done, could have, would have, should have, is just seal this a little bit better, and that wouldn't occur. But like I say, I'm a hobbyist. I'm trying to relate to you as hobbyists. So when you find things that aren't perfect, you take the time to implement techniques that can help you. What I'm going to do is going to leave a little bit of this fletching, so each one will have a little bit of an undercut there. The one thing I don't want to do is cut too far. A lot of times you can go and hold it up. Like I say, what we're trying to do is cut beyond, not go to the edge. That's probably fine. I'm going to leave the ear ones intact where they're going over a little bit. And I'll show you on the casting process what you'll do for that. I could leave this whole thing intact. But the risk if you leave it intact is, if it does tear one day, it doesn't tear the way you want it to. So by doing this, you make it less vulnerable to tears. And if anything does tear further, it's along the lines of where you scored it or cut it. I'll go back one more time. Just take the jagged stuff off. Like I say, this doesn't need to be here. If I had done more prep, this is so long ago I made this, I couldn't remember what I had done. I could have done more work to it before I did the mold, but it's actually good because we're just hobbyists and we're going to have some loose ends, as I was explaining the other day. It's how we handle those loose ends when we have them that get us to where we're going. Obviously, if we're doing this every day and this is our manufacturing process and our breadwinning thing that we do, we'd learn just from once or twice having this experience and not have it again. But that's not me. I'm a hobbyist. Oh, that reminds me. I had somebody mention a comment about sales. I don't want to be about sales. So I took it down. I would have let, no offense, I would have just told you, hey, don't say things about that kind of thing, because that's not what this channel's about. But I know you're listening because you're a regular. Would you please comment that again, but not say that a thing about the sales? Because that's not what we're about. And I know I don't make that very clear, so please don't take any offense by that. And there you go. No, it's not the tucking in of my shirt. That's not the thing you're looking for. It's something more obvious than that. And there you go. This mold is clean, as they say in the Poltergeist movie, right? Now, my high quality, very expensive computer panel is unmarred, ready for the next mold. We're ready to cast. Let me show you how to cast. No, there's no casting couch. It's just way more simple than that and much more equitable and fair. Okay, I've mixed up my resin. Got my pigment in there. Everything is acceptable on this. I don't see anything that's wrong with it. I'm gonna show you how to do it. I'll put in a little bit like this and I'll move it around. And what we wanna do is we wanna get it in when it's nice and light, because when you shake it and you mix it, you get a little bit of some air bubbles. And you want those air bubbles to have a chance to go to the top. So for a moment, everything in every place on here is pretty much thin enough to let the air bubble go to the top. One last thing we're gonna do is we're gonna force this in to all the sides, everywhere that it could have possibly gotten stuck and had an undercut or a bubble or whatever form, because it didn't go in there, it wasn't coaxed in there. We're gonna coax it. And then we're gonna run it along the other sides with the Q-tip, just like this, because once you've got it everywhere it needs to be, and you can do this a little bit to get rid of any other air bubbles, but you've touched all the places several times that there could have been a problem. That's important. Then you simply go around and I can see if there's any other air bubbles or inconsistencies in my mixture, which there shouldn't be if you mix it plenty well. You go around, you fill it up to where you want it to be. And I'm starting to see that the table is slightly tilting. So what I do is, instead of being on the side of the table like this, oh, and by the way, every time you've got a little bit left, you just fill up something else. Don't throw it away. And eventually you get the other piece. One of the things I do, I'm not gonna move it over for this video because I'll be out of the shot right now. But one of the things I do, if I have to be on a slight tilt, remember I was saying yesterday that the table was a little bit off and it was gonna be negligible? Well, it is, but here's what I do. You see how that's starting to go out like that? I figure out what way it's tilting if I'm on an uneven surface, and I simply correct. And one last thing I do is just go around and push anything that might have spilled in there and clean up the edge. And I could be neater if I wasn't talking to you guys and I was thinking more about what I'm doing. And I could make sure I was on a level surface first. I talked about earlier how I'll curve this. I can't do that yet, but I'm gonna show you how I do it. So I'm gonna wait and I'm gonna show you how I do that last step. Okay, are you looking for the thing that appeared and disappeared? This time it's real easy. When we get better at this, if we keep doing it, might be like a spot on my shirt will go away or something like that, really small. If you like reading those People magazines at the end, there's always like the compare the two pictures, find the things. I like doing that. Okay, I'm a drummer, right? So the first thing I do when I break a drumstick is say, can I use that? Well, you can't do this every time, but you can use it to stir things, and I do. Well, look at how many times that's been stirred. You can tell it's got brown paint on it right now. basically what I do now is make sure it's cured enough where it won't wash around, and just simply get the curve like that. And then I'll wait down the middle a little bit. And that's all we do when you create something on a flat, but you want to give it to someone curved. Simple as that. So we'll come back in just a little bit and I'll show you how to finish it up, and then you'll have the full thing. Hey, it's the simplest piece that I do basically, but you wanted me to mold something and you wanted me to show you how to do it, I'm doing it. I shared a lot of things over the years with my bat buddies, probably too much. But one of the things I haven't done is show some of the things that I do in the other parts of the cave. Because if I can't make this go like I didn't with those neck pieces, and I didn't think I could, then the whole thing just is just for fun. And as you see, I'm saying, give me comments. You know, this is what makes it fun. Otherwise, I didn't need to have this camera going. I don't need to share this. It's about the camaraderie. It always has been for me, because I was at the drawing table as a child, as a young artist, and I wanted to get away from the drawing table and do other things. So one of the things that I try to do when I do my work, just like when I was an artist, I wanted to frame it and put it on a wall somewhere. It was much more finalized and good. I got to the point where I threw out a portfolio that was this thick in art school. And I mean, you know, think of a book that thick. You can't frame things. So what do I do with ideas? I use ideas and perspectives for conscious counseling. What do I do with bat things? I do Batman hobby things for myself, and there's a trail over for others. But I can't do this every single day and just be a lone hobbyist like the Lone Ranger in my isolation of my bat cave. No, I can see already I'm not gonna reach the numbers. So what I do is say, let's have some fun by turning on the camera and doing these things that I do. That's what this channel's about. So we'll come back in a minute. We'll show you how this goes. All right, so we'll go ahead and demold this, and we'll do the finishing video next time. So basically we have the curve now built into it, okay? And we're gonna go around very nice and neatly like this, and just very delicately, especially the first time, to make sure that everything comes off nicely, and just, okay, very nice. So there you have it. Now what I'll do is I'll talk on the next video about how we take this to the next step and make it so that you can use it for your belt, or I can use it for my belt, or any bat buddy can do anything they want with it. You can throw a strike in the bat cave wall if you sharpen the corners, I don't know. Anyway, that's it. That's the video for today, bat buddies. I'm Paul Roberts, Artsy1. How can I get out of here today?